Psalms 34. How many of you guys are actively involved in a cadre? Awesome. That's the problem. Listen, you must connect with somebody at church. You must have a connection. We have three things that we focus on when we have a youth meeting last night. And so we're like, all right, how can we jumpstart our young people? And a lot of you guys are currently, you come to church, you sit in the pews, and that's it. You may be involved in different areas of the church, but you may not be. Listen, I came from a family. This is a free message right here. I came from a family that grew up in church, and for all purposes, we were Christians. But my sister went haywire, bless her heart. She's trying to come back to Jesus now. And my brother and my other sister, they're loving the Lord the best they can. But their lives came up and down, with God and with life and things like that. And listen, they heard the same scriptures I heard. They sat in the same pews I sat in. Mama smacked them in the back of the head when they did wrong too. They got the same treatment I did. And my life has continued. Literally, I was up and hanging out with some family members, and my uncle, he says, "Dude, Nate, you are different. What's wrong with you? Like, you are completely..." He said, "You should get a paternity test. Find out whether you're not related to us or something, because you are so different than the rest of the family." And you know what made the difference? At 14, I got on the worship team, and I had to be there. I had to be in church, and it wasn't pastor's church. It was my church. It was my responsibility. I had to be involved, and so there was a buy-in factor for me to love God, and there was just something about keeping your butt in church through it all. And my buddy, he is, you guys went to Generation Unleashed? You ever heard of Generation Unleashed? There's a lead singer, there used to be a lead singer, now other people are doing it, but he's like 36, 37, something like that, and his parents, they went through a divorce when he was like 8 or 9, and just a horrible kind of time for a little kid, and he says, "The only thing that kept me was that I kept myself in church." And so I just want to encourage you. His story is exactly the same as mine. And now he's gone on to, you know, do some albums, and he's on staff. He's actually over all the worship team in City Bible. They have 4 campuses, and he just kept going. And his story is very same as mine. Why? Because he stayed in church. I know it sounds so simple and so silly, but I promise you, if you will keep your rear end in church, and you will involve yourself. And this is kind of what I'm talking about tonight. But if you'll take it, church, from your head to your heart, it'll really benefit you. You'll get more out of it. And so I encourage you, if you're not currently involved in anything, get involved in something. If you don't know what to do, try. Ask something. Say, "Hey, can I run cameras? Can I serve some food? Can I help out in the babies? Can I do something?" Where you begin to own the church, and it's yours, okay? And we allow you guys to work in every area of church. There's no reason for you just to come and sit in the pews. I want to encourage you to get involved somewhere, okay? Psalms 34, you guys there? You guys there? All right. I'm super excited, and we have officially, is it May? No, it's not May. One thing Megan forgot to tell you is that we are having a competition in the month of May. Whoever brings the most visitors through the month of May, the first Wednesday in June, we will have a pizza party for you. And it actually has nothing to do with size. And so if you guys have this many young people, but you bring more visitors, then you win. And sometimes I don't want the highest numbers overall. I'm talking about visitors, people, your friends who do not know Jesus coming to church. And so, huh? Can you bring tiny people? What do you mean? No, gnomes don't count. Younger siblings, no, they have to be youth age. So, whatever service brings the most young people to a visiting thing, you get a free pizza party in the first week in June. And so just throw that out there, see if there's a little incentive there for you to bring your friends. Psalms 34, "I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall sometimes be in my mouth. My soul," what does it say, sometimes? It says all times. "The humble shall hear of it and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all my fears. I looked to him, and were radiant. They looked at him and were radiant. Their faces were not ashamed. Go down to verse 8. It says, oh, taste and see. The Lord is good. Blessed is the man who trusts in him. Oh, fear the Lord, you his saints. There is no want for those who fear him. The young lions lack and the suffer hunger, but those who seek the Lord will lack no good thing. Look at your neighbor and say, those who seek God. Look at your neighbor real loud. Some of you guys didn't even look at your neighbor. Say, look at your neighbor and say, those who seek God shall not lack any good thing. Shall not lack any good thing. Let's pray. Tonight I'm going to speak to you on the subject of what's inside you. What's inside you? If you're taking notes, write that down. What's inside you? Father, we thank you for your word tonight. We thank you for helping me preach, helping the students listen. And God, we're excited about you. Lord, I don't care if everybody in the world is down on you. I'm excited about you. I love you, and I'm excited for what you're doing. I know these young people are excited. I know the word's going forth in these young people. We thank you for a whole grip of world changers. In Jesus' name. And Father, I pray for this group, that they would be the ones to win the pizza party, that they would bring more friends and be more attentive. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. I do pray the same thing over the second service, by the way. Just got to throw that out there. How many guys have ever been to an exotic land? Anywhere? You know, my wife and I, we've just changed our plans. We might be going to an exotic land in a couple of weeks, and we were going to drive. Do you know how expensive driving is? It's very expensive. I began to calculate our costs and hotels and everything, and it began to make me realize I don't want to be driving for 30 hours for that cost. And so we might be changing. But I have been to Cancun before, and I've preached this message before, but I just feel like talking about it again. How many of you guys have ever been to a place like Cancun or Hawaii, or who's been to Hawaii? No. When I actually went to Hawaii, I was imagining paradise. It's actually nothing like that. It's a lot of pineapple, and it was all right. But when I went to Cancun, Tan, not to diss on the homeland, bro, but I went to Cancun. And I remember when I went up to Cancun, the sun sets actually, oh, sorry, the sun rises over the water. And it's pretty cool, you know, because it's on the east side of the sun. Did I say that right? Yeah, it rises over the water. So I woke up at 5 a.m. and we got in at 10 o'clock at night. And so I ran to the door and I began to look outside. And I was like, oh, hey, nothing special. It's kind of humid. So I jumped back in bed and went back to bed. I came out again at like 7 or 8 or whatever time I woke up. And I went to the balcony and I said, oh my goodness. The most turquoise water you've ever seen. It literally blew me away. It literally I remember Megan, get up. You got to look at this. And the water there is so turquoise, and it's the Caribbean. And if I never go back to Hawaii, I'll be all right. I need to go back to Cancun. And I've been trying to figure out a way to get back. It's been 5 years already now. I can't believe it that it's been that long. I'm having withdrawals. But I can begin to tell you about Cancun. I can begin to tell you it's got turquoise water like any turquoise you've ever seen. And it never gets old. It never, I was there for 10 days. Thank Jesus, that was awesome. It's like turquoise, like your shoes. And I remember, it's like 9 o'clock, and I'm like, baby, I'm gonna just go walk with the beach by myself one more time before we leave. And I'm just like looking at the water, and I'm like, oh my goodness. And if you've ever talked to me, I've told you about Cancun. How many of you guys have I ever talked to you about Cancun? And I'm the biggest advertiser for Cancun, Mexico. And Megan's even like, we're thinking about going, and she's like, we should go somewhere else. I'm like, no, we're not going anywhere else. We're going to the Caribbean. And I don't know. No, what? Dominican Republic. But it might be worse. I don't know, because I know Cancun, and it's amazing. And I could sit here and I could describe, and many of you guys have said, man, I've never been there. I've never even think, I don't know what exactly you're talking about. Okay, yeah, Ecuador's very similar. But I could begin to tell you and tell you and tell you. But you know, there's something about experiencing it. Until you hit your toes, and the way this, we for about 6 feet, for some reason there were shells. It's probably from the waves, but the waves pick up the shells, and we're like, oh, and we start walking, and we're like, this is amazing. And then we're like, oh, ow, oh, ow. For like 6 feet, there's like nothing but rocks and shells. And then you get in and it's normal sand and you're like, eh. But at first, it took us like a day, full day. We're like, oh, how do people even go in there? It's like literally cutting your feet, like, ow, 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 ow. And we're like, it looks beautiful. But and then the lady told us, you got to go a little bit further. And we're like, oh, okay. And we went a little further. And then finally, oh, okay. It's amazing. And I want to kind of tell you, I could describe the food. I had these little crabs things. They're like crabs. And they're soft-shelled crabs in the Caribbean. And you don't like pluck them, you throw them in your mouth and you eat them, just shell and all. It's the most awkward thing in the world. They're like little spiders and you're eating them. And but they were amazing. And so we're actually going, if we go, heaven, we might go. I don't know. But I love it. You ride you go to the movie theater and it's like $2 to see a movie and it's in English with Spanish subtitles. You don't even like, who cares? And one night it was like $2. The other night the guy figured out that we were Americans and he charged us $6. We're like, who cares? You know, still $6 for a movie. And so it's awesome. People say Mexico's unsafe or whatever. No, it's not. We were catching taxis at 11 o'clock at night and nobody's around. I mean, it's fine. And now I've got Krav Maga. I'm like, come on, please, tack me. I've been waiting. I've been practicing. I'm ready for you. And so I love Cancun. But it doesn't do you any good. Like right now, you could be like, dude, I want to. Who could say, man, I kind of want to go right now? Okay, awesome. If I said, I will give you an all-expense-paid trip to Cancun right now, who would say, yes, give that to me? Okay, awesome. Every one of us. You know, it doesn't really, like I said, I can make you want it, but it's just something about experiencing it for yourself. And young people, if today this is the transition for you, I'm afraid for our young people in general, the churchgoers, if you do not take God from head knowledge into heart knowledge, it's not nearly as good. Right now, you can leave this place and you'd be like, whoa, Cancun's awesome. But you don't want to really go like I want to go, trust me. I want to go. You don't want to go that bad. Why? Because you haven't been there. You don't get it. If you went there, and well, at least if you're like me and you like it, you might want to go somewhere else really bad like I do. But I love that place. I can move that place. I think the Lord is calling me to be a missionary to Cancun, Mexico. No, he's not. I wouldn't get any work done. I'd be like getting a tan and stuff. But when it comes to the things of God, man, Tan, I could tell you, like, man, God wants to direct your life. He wants to tell you exactly what college to go to. He wants to tell you what girl to marry. He wants to tell you what job to get. He wants to lead you even down to what car you buy and every aspect of your life. Man, he wants you healthy. He wants you wealthy. He wants you blessed. Man, he's going to take you further. And I can tell you all about it, but if you don't begin to experience it for yourself, there'll be this like, meh, hmm. I don't know. People like, you know, somebody like, man, who wants something right now? Shout out something that you want. Dirt bike, yes. Horse. Have fun, Dad. What else? Nobody wants anything? Apple Watch? I want an Apple Watch right now. A cat. There we go. A cat? Really? If I'm a genie, I'm like, you can have anything you want. A cat! I'm like, why? Okay, listen, many of us like a house, that's a little on my lines. Listen, God, God's not just a vending machine, but you can. The Bible says that God gives you the desires of your heart. Like, you can pray for something down to an ice maker in the house, and God will make sure you get an ice maker in your house. Do you realize how cool that is? Do you know that even cooler than that is walking up into somebody and knowing something by the help of the Holy Spirit and Him using, God using you, the God who created eternity, He created eternity too, but I meant He created the universe. He created every speck and everything. But He sits there and He anoints you to talk and to encourage other people to say things that you had no clue about. You look cool. God looks cool. And you just walk away like, whoa. But unless you experience it, you don't have a clue what I'm talking about. That desire isn't really even there. You're like, eh. And so therefore, you can continue wanting your horse. You can continue wanting your bike, your cat. whatever you want and kind of being like the rest of the world, I hope I get it. I hope I fall under it. And guys, I want to challenge you to begin to seek God with everything you've got and begin to ask yourself, do I believe this thing? Not my mama. Listen, we can be convincing. Look, dude, I'm wearing a red shirt, I've got cool hair, and I'm a youth pastor that speaks loudly, and I talk about whatever. And I could, like, convince you God is the best thing. But do you know God? Do you know God? Do you know about God? Are you just believing what I'm telling you? I hope none of us are that naive. I hope none of us are just robots where we're like, well, mama says I gotta go to church. Listen, that will keep you until you're about 21 years old. And I want to challenge you tonight. Listen, God wants to direct you in your school. God wants to use you in your school. God wants you to lead a club of people and begin to impact people around you that will echo through eternity. God wants you to lead you to the exact woman for you guys, that a woman that will get along with you, a woman that will be a helpmate to you, a woman that will not be annoying. Well, she might be annoying some days, but she won't be more annoying than some others. You know what I'm saying? Like, it'll be bad without God. And ladies, he's got an exact guy out there that you can actually fall in love with and be like, man, he's going to lead my family correctly. But listen, if your head's in the clouds, you're not even listening. You're not even trying. You're not even seeking. You're not even searching out for this God who's amazing. And I can tell you all about it. I can tell you, guys, I'm even talking to God today. I'm like, dude, it's so cool that, like, I feel like I'm honestly in the plan of God for my life. Am I always doing everything right? No. Am I perfect? Far from. But I can say, God, I'm not going to Cancun because I know your plan for my life. And guys, the coolest thing is to know your purpose. The coolest thing is to sit back and be like, I'm exactly where I'm supposed to be. I'm exactly where I'm supposed to be. I'm not shining God on. I'm not trying to pretend. I'm exactly where he wants me. Am I doing everything perfect? No, hear me out. What I'm saying is there's something about in your life when you say, I'm exactly where I'm supposed to be. I'm doing what God called me to do. I've been made for this. I was born for this. There's a passion. There's a vibrancy. If you can't do that, why? If I told you can go to Cancun anytime you want, you and your family, whatever, you'd be like, let's go. Tomorrow, pack up and leave. And guys, I promise you, God is so much cooler than Cancun. He's amazing. Just, it's like God and then a little bit Cancun. But he's still better. God's amazing. Life with him is amazing. You could be, you're sitting there at a car dealership, like, yeah, I want to buy this car. Inside, the Holy Ghost says, nah, don't buy this car. You're like, all right, peace. Then you go up the road a little piece and get exactly what you need. That's cool. Guys, you could be parenting one day. You have a teenage daughter, a teenage son, and you be praying, you know, just loving the Lord in your house, and all of a sudden God says, your teenage son, they're not supposed to be dating, but they are dating. Go into the bedroom and talk to them about it. You go and say, hey, son, daughter, God just told me that you're dating and you're not supposed to be, And you know, I forgive you already for that, but let's talk about it. Son or daughter's like, poof, my face is just blown off. How do they know? What just happened there? You encountered Jesus, the truth of God's word, the leading of the Holy Spirit. Guys, do you know that this is real? That turquoise water in Cancun, it's real. It's amazing. It's right there. But unless you experience it, do you realize that you could get to the place where the Holy Spirit comes alongside with you and prays so that you're not just praying out of your head? You're not just like, oh, God, Jesus, God, if you're Father, God, if you're willing, God, I love those kind of prayers. But God, I don't know what else to say, so in Jesus' name, amen. Do you know that prayer can get to the point where you just safrota, safrara, berefru, korome, get, you begin to be caught up in the third heaven. You can be caught up. You can look at your watch and be like, whoa, how did 3 hours pass? And I was praying for people in Peru. I was praying for people in here. And man, I just felt used. And guys, I've been to the point where God's glued me down on the floor and I can't get up. That's kind of fun. It's just like, whoa. To the point where I sense the anointing, especially at Encounter, the anointing will just come and it feels like fire on my hands. And I'm not trying to be weird, and we don't really care about weirdness, and I actually don't like weirdness. I'm like the exact opposite of weirdness. If you actually know me, like, I'm not gonna run and dance and spit up green stuff. I'm not really like that. I'm super like reserved. I could be at my favorite concert in the whole world and be like, yeah, I like these guys. You know, like, that's just kind of who I am. Even in Cancun, I'll just be like, you know, I'm not really demonstrative, but you know, one thing about God is he's so real. And like, I've sat under his anointing before and just been like, dude, you're amazing. And listen, Cece, if you've never experienced it, you don't know what I'm talking about. Riley, man, if you don't dig into it, you won't have to experience it. Sometimes, you know, Arnold Schwarzenegger, that big old guy with big muscles and the Terminator. Sometimes people are like, well, I don't ever want to look like that guy. I don't ever want to be there. And he would say, don't worry, you won't. Because it takes a lot of work to kind of get there. You know what I mean? And the things of the Spirit, they're not just going to fall on you. Well, I shouldn't say that all the way. What happens with God is you give an inch and he gives you a yard. You give him a yard, he'll give you 10 yards. He responds to your seeking. And he responds bigger, obviously. I remember very, very young in age, I just began praying. Guys, I didn't know anything about anything. I didn't get anything out of anything. I didn't, but I just said, you know what? God told me, or my youth pastor told me, that I should be praying every day. And so I'll start praying every day. And that's it, Lord. And I would say this all the time. God, I love you. I want more of you. Use me. I would pray. Sometimes it was dry. Sometimes it was boring. Sometimes I looked at my watch 40 times in that 1 hour, but I kept saying, God, I love you. I want to be used by you. And it got to the point where, man, I'd get up to pray for an offering and the Holy Ghost would hit me. I'd be like, why am I crying right now? I just cried. I don't know why I'm crying. And the manifestation, it would be like God just put his hand upon me and said, hey, this is my presence. Get used to my anointing. And guys, the farthest thing in my mind was to fall for the things of the world. You know what I mean? Like, I giggled. The world's like, oh, here's the marijuana. You want some? Oh, look, we're all having a party today. It's going to be so amazing. Go on ahead. Go lie to your parents. It's all right. Be like, dude, you don't even know God. He's amazing. There was no draw. Well, why? Because God was in my face. If my parents quit going to church, I would have to bum a ride from people because I still love God. And guys, it's got to come down from your head into your heart. I'm talking to every one of you tonight. I'm talking to every single one of you tonight. How's your relationship with God? Not your daddy's relationship with God. Not your mommy's relationship with God. How is your relationship with God? How much word do you know? And listen to me. I'm not talking about just repeating it mumbly. Like, I know for John 3:16, God's the love of the world. I know that one. Children obey your parents. My mom yells that one at me all the time. I know that one. No. Do you know it? My last little thought was, I'm not going to go there, but you know, God accommodates you where you're at. And many of you guys have not had a choice, really. And I know, Cece, you just come to church. You got a drug problem. You know, if your mama's going to drag you to church, that's the end of the story. And that's fine. And that's cool. And that works for a little while. It really does. It's like, oh, thanks, Mom. But at some point, all of us, myself included, we had to make this decision of like, I don't care whether Mom drags me to church. I'm going to church. And if you haven't made that decision yet, I challenge you to. It starts, this is how it starts. You are running in a race and God is chasing after you. If you would turn towards him, he will run into you. He will smack you and you're like, whoa, God's amazing. But it takes you turning. It takes you like getting serious and saying, God, I want you more. I want to know you more. I want to know your voice so that I can know which way I need to take life. And listen, guys, there are so many adults who do not know the voice of God. They're distracted. They don't know anything. And they're going from job to place and moving their family and barely making it. And God's like, man, I've got so much for you, but you are so busy that you do not take time to listen and to hear and to heed my voice. And so therefore, I can't do anything with you. God's so busy chasing them around that they don't even stop and say, God, what's your plan for my life? And guys, I don't know about you. I don't want to be like that. I want to be smack dab in the middle of what God's got for me. No plan B, no other agenda, no other plan. Just be like, dude, God's amazing. I can't believe he's taken me this far. I don't know what else he's got. And so, but God will accommodate you where you're at. There's a story in the Bible called Doubting Thomas. Open up your Bibles to, it's like John 24. And Thomas, he's considered Doubting Thomas because he had this attitude like, well, I'm not going to believe God unless I put my hands in his hole, he put my hole in his little hand in his through the scars. I'm not going to believe unless I see him and the scar in his side. I'm not going to, unless I touch it, I won't believe. And you think that Jesus would have wrote about this doubting Thomas and he would be like, all right, fine, Thomas, go to hell. See ya. But he didn't. He came and he actually said, I'll accommodate your stupidity. And actually, he showed up and he says, go ahead, Thomas. Put your fingers in. Because some of you guys are analytical. Some of you guys, you are doing such a good job obeying your parents. You're just here because they told you to come. And you're fine. But I challenge you to say, God, I want to touch you. I challenge you. It's okay to say, God, I want to touch you. God, I want to know who you are. God, I want to feel your presence. God, I think that's okay. Yes, we should believe. Yes, you should. But sometimes that's hard. Sometimes that you don't believe. Sometimes you're too analytical. Sometimes whatever. Good news is Jesus is right here saying, yeah, go ahead. He's promised us that if we seek him, we'll find him. If we turn to him, he'll be found by us. God is not running from you. He's running to you. God is not saying, 1, 2, 3, you can't catch me. But he's saying, seek me, you'll find me. Knock, the door will be open. Ask, you'll find. It's just that. It's just that simple. Look at this story. So Thomas called the twin. It's 20:24, John 20:24. Now Thomas called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. And the other disciples therefore said to them, we have seen the Lord. So he said, unless I see his hands, the print of nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails and put my hand into his side, I will not believe. Listen to little Miss Debbie Doubter, you know. And after 8 days, look at this. So Thomas is in this place of all his buddies are telling him that, man, God is good. Man, Jesus is here, just like I'm telling you tonight. Man, God is good. Man, Riley, God loves you. Man, he wants to use you and will give you word of knowledge and show you how to take your school and show you exactly what you need to do and show you what school you should go to after college and give you an exact plan. God wants to, and you're like, yeah. Unless he tells me, I ain't believing. And I think that's a negative attitude because Jesus said so. But look at Jesus still. He accommodated Thomas, and I just love this. And after 8 days, his disciples were again inside again, and Thomas was with them, and Jesus came, and the doors were shut. Whoa! So it says that the doors were shut and locked up, and Jesus is like, hey, what's up? He's like, I go through doors. And he stood in the midst of them, and he says, peace to you. It's like, oh, crap. That's why he said peace, because they're probably freaking out. Then Thomas, and I love this. And so Thomas is like, whoa, there's Jesus. And Jesus says, Thomas, reach your finger here. Look at my hands and reach your hand here. And he put it on my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believing. It's just such, could you imagine Thomas? He would have been like drooling at this point and like, you know, because he knew his negative attitude. He knew, but you know what's cool is Jesus got right down right with him. I want to challenge you tonight. Turn to Jesus. Turn your relationship inside and check. How much are you crazy in love with God? Are you crazy in love with God? Are you crazy in love with his presence? Are you crazy in, do you literally have, does God have your everything? Are you completely in love with him? It doesn't matter whether you're on the floor. It doesn't matter. Jesus would get down right with you, look you in the eye, say, here, touch my hand. Don't be unbelieving. Be believing. And I don't think you have to tell Thomas that Jesus is real. I don't think from that moment on, you had to come up to Thomas and say, hey, Thomas, are you, he probably hated it. Everybody's always calling me Doubting Thomas. I don't doubt anymore, but I'm getting labeled as Doubting Thomas. This guy doubted once. How about we be believing Christians? How about from here on out tonight, we just dedicate our lives to Christ. From here on out tonight, we're just going to do what God's called us to do. We're going to seek him with all of our heart. We're going to take our relationship with him very seriously. And we're going to make sure that what we do echoes for eternity. Look at this, Jeremiah 29:11. We know this scripture, and this is something like I write down. It's one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible. Jeremiah 29:11. It says, for I know the thoughts that I'm thinking towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, and to give you a future and a hope. And that's awesome. You're like, yeah, I love that part. But look at 12. He says, and this is what I want you to do tonight. I want you to do tonight. I want you to do tomorrow. I want you to do for the rest of your life. It says, then you put your name in there. When you call upon me and go and pray to me, I will listen to you. And when you seek me and find me, when you search for me with all your heart. That's it. That's all I want from us. CC, I want you down on your face at home, all by yourself, with no one's around, and saying, God, show me you. I want to touch your hands. I want to know your voice. I want to be acquainted with your spirit. I want God. And think about that, rep. And now listen, if you want to step back and say, well, I'm not going to believe that, or I don't want to believe that, and I'm not going to press into God. And well, don't worry. God's not going to show himself to you. Like Arnold says, don't worry. You won't have a body like that. You don't worry. The Spirit of God is not going to jump on top of you and all of a sudden start shaking you and taking you over. That's not how God works. I don't believe in healing. Well, don't worry. You won't get healed. I want to challenge you. Turn around. Face the Lord. Look at him. Seek him. Seek his face. Get to know him. Get to know his spirit. Let's not have this be our parents' religion. Let's not have it be mommy, daddy's reason I come to church. But if they quit, I would still have to come because God's more real to me than that. Can we do that? Can we make a pact tonight as a youth ministry that we're going to give everything we got? Now listen, 120 people changed the world. 120 people radically changed. What do you think? We've got probably about 17, 20 we've been averaging in here. What would happen if all of you guys got on fire for God? What kind of effect would you have in your community? What kind of effect would you have in your school? I think it would be greater than ball games. I think it would be greater than, you know, winning and stuff like that. I think it would be something that would literally echo through eternity. But remember, it doesn't just fall on you. You have to turn and seek him. And the second you do, he's right there. You give him an inch, he'll give you a yard. You give him 1 yard of your life, he'll give you 10 yards of your life. And I think tonight we need to get serious. I think tonight, some of you guys, you've felt the drawing of God. You've felt the wooing of God. You've enjoyed it so far, but you know what? It's easy to pick it up and to put it back down again. Like, yeah, that's awesome. I love God. He's right over there when I need him. And I don't want you to live like that anymore. I want you to live like tomorrow morning when you go to school. Say, God, what do you got for me? God, what's your plan today? What's your plan tomorrow? How can I be more useful to you? How can I make a bigger impact on my team? How can I be better used? And listen, some of you guys are like hanging up your calling. Some of you guys are supposed to be in the ministry and you know it and you feel it. You've sensed it. You've known it for if somebody interviewed you right now, say, what do you think you got for your life? Honestly, come on, cut to the chase. You'd be like, I'm probably supposed to be in the ministry of some sort. And you've felt that mantle, you felt that call, you felt that drawing, and you're like, yeah, that's a cool jacket. And you've like put it up on the shelf and you've hung it up and you've said, man, I'm gonna wear that one day. I'm gonna wear that one day. It's gonna be awesome. Right now I'm just gonna do this. And I challenge you, that mantle is not for, this is by the Spirit of God I'm saying that. This mantle is not for the future, it's for now. That responsibility, the ministry that God has for you, it's not for hanging on the shelf. that mantle and that responsibility starts now. And actually, if you be faithful in this mantle now, he'll give you more later on. But if you're not faithful in it, that mantle will just stay there and not grow and not thrive and not flourish and not accomplish what it's been sent out to do. There's a responsibility in us, in you, to take what God's given us and put it on like a coat and be like that nerdy kid at school that wears the same clothes every single day. You put it on and say, man, I'm never taking this off. I'm called of the Lord. I have a purpose and I have a destiny. I'm not backing down from it. And listen, the devil cannot take you out. With that heart, I don't care if every storm hits your life. You just look at him and say, so what? I've got God. I don't care if whatever happens to your parents, whatever happens to your family, whatever happens to the ups and the downs and the storms. I don't care. I got God. I don't need anything else. I don't have any friends. You know the people who complain about friends, unaware that they're walking around with Jesus? You know the people, I'm so lonely. I'm just going to Facebook post that. I'm lonely tonight. All my buddies, they got girlfriends. They've been in love for 2 weeks. But I'm here alone. I'm 14 and I'm alone. My mommy's in the other room, but I'm alone tonight. You are unaware of who's really with you. You're unaware of God and his presence. Challenge you in this tonight. Come on, let's pray. Every head bowed, every eye closed. And I want a response from you guys tonight. If this struck a chord with you, man, if you're in here and you just say, man, I'm just going to live a little bit differently. And I'm not even talking that you're in sin or you're in some dark place, but you maybe feel like you've hung up that mantle and you've been kind of ignoring God and you've not been active in your faith. And tonight, even just after this message, I want you to, just on the count of three, I want you to say, yes, Pastor Nate, pray with me. And I'm not going to lay hands on you. I just want out of your own heart, no one looking around, no one messing around. If that's you and you say, man, that struck a chord in me tonight. And from here on out, I'm going to seek God. And I'm not coming to youth alone. I'm not coming to church alone. I'm not letting the devil distract me any longer, but I'm going to focus. I'm going to turn around. I'm going to seek God with all my heart. I'm going to make sure that God's coming down from my head into my heart. If that's you, on the count of three, one. Come on, young people. Maybe your heart's pounding now. You're like, yeah, this is me. This is what I need to do. This is where I need to refocus. And listen, it's not just a focusing on yourself. It's a focusing on God. It's a seeking him. It's a dependency on him. Two, no one messing around. Three, raise your hand. If that's you, say, yeah, that struck a chord in me. I'm going to live for God all the days of my life from here on out. Come on, raise your hand high and bold if that's you. I'm going to seek God. I'm going to be counted as a Christian. I'm going to be walking my hallway differently. Come on, I just want to know who I'm praying for. I'm going to focus from here on out. I'm going to do what God's called me to do. There's no other plan except God's plan for my life. All right, let me pray for these people. Father, I lift these young people up. Lord, they were bold enough to raise their hands. And Lord, it's just a little sign. It's just a little, you know, hand raise and whatever. But Father, it means the world to you. And Father, I come alongside them in faith. And Lord, I pray that from here on out, Lord, they will be different. Lord, I pray from here on out, Lord, they begin to seek you, Lord, just like I sought you in the early days. And Lord, that was by your grace and that by your help. And Father, I pray that you are drawing these young people for more time with you. And a seriousness would come over this youth ministry. In Jesus' name, we thank you for it. Everybody said, amen. You believe that?